My name is Charles Wilfong. I'm a tax preparer local in the area. I guess I've been doing this about 7, 8 years on Main Street down here.
Knocked at the door.
Before that, other places. Basically, what I'm going to go over tonight is tax deductions that you may or may never heard of, or maybe you thought you could take them, and maybe you can or can't. I don't know how many people here do their own tax returns. Use TurboTax or something like that, or? HR Block. Well, I'll tell you, 90% of my business comes from HR Block customers. Don't know why, but HR Block and some other people. But the reason is, you know, basically, you know, I guess someone like myself has been doing this since I was in college. I actually took a course when I was in college on how to do income taxes to make some extra money. And during the 1971-73, I remember it was all done by paper then, but I remember working at a place by City Hall. It was like a guy's name, I can't even remember it anymore. But basically on April 14th and 15th, we would do 35, 40 returns by hand. And probably make about $15-$20 a return for a rich. You know, work all night, pen and pennies. You know, calculators weren't that good back then. You know, it was a difficult process, and kind of really learn how to get the stuff done by doing it back then that way, then through the years away, it kept changing. I guess the biggest change came in 1985 when they changed the tax rules, and they made it so you couldn't take depreciation as easy as you could in the past. You couldn't buy a fund and have depreciation passed to you. They divided income into passive, non-passive, and started doing all other kinds of things to the tax law. Now, I don't know if anybody really knows it, but the last couple of years, there's been a lot of sneaky changes coming in, and every year, there's about 35 deductions that have to be reapproved because they're not ongoing. Mortgage interest deduction was not approved till December 21st of this year. So if they didn't approve that, we wouldn't be deducting that right now.
Oh,
oh boy.
You know, things like that. Charitable deductions were also knocked off. The big ones that the people were calling me and everybody else was the business deduction called 179, where you can buy equipment for up to $500,000, deduct it right away, instead of deducting over 7 years or 10 years or whatever. Business people didn't know that they could deduct this until December 21st. How are they gonna buy stuff? You know, I do a body shop, and they wanted to buy lifts and things to straighten out cars and all this all year long, and the owners didn't buy it. So it just didn't happen, because there wasn't enough time by the time they passed the law. You know, how many jobs that's lost because they didn't pass that in time. You know, every year it's the biggest thing. I guess it really started maybe about 10 years ago when you could deduct, if you bought a laptop, you could deduct the whole thing personally, stuff like that. Well, real into where you could deduct $500,000. And when they take, if they take that away, it's gonna hurt. You know, but that's a business deduction. And if we have small businesses, anybody here, a side business or something,
then, self-employed.
You know, he probably talks about maybe if he buys, depending on what kind of business it is. But one of the things we're looking at right now is, you know, on the slideshow itself, it's gonna be a little awkward doing this here, but. People that work for the IRS themselves, all they do is comment that people leave thousands and thousands of dollars on the table. Everybody's trying to get the most, you know, try not to mess up, but next thing you know, they leave major things. That's why when I get people come in from H&R Block from the prior year and we look at their return or 2 years back, sometimes there's blatant mistakes. And I don't know if it's because the preparer is 1 or 2 years doing it. If the preparer's been there 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 years, it's probably pretty good. But if you get someone new, you know, you're probably not getting a good job done. It's just like if you went to a doctor, you want to be the first person to have a heart operation, you want to be the first person to have a liver transplant. It's the same thing. You know, tax preparers, everything in life is the same thing.
But doesn't like the software really guide you today?
Well, the software that I use, costs about $3,500. The software that some home preparers use costs about $78. TurboTax, I don't know. So there's a big difference in what I use and what they use. I have to actually study this software in December for days on days to see what the changes are and everything else. It's a lot more sophisticated versus what the normal person on the street has. So, yeah, it does help, but you still need to know, you know. And I know TurboTax will kind of ask you questions.
Right.
Do you know, professional software doesn't. You know, you have to kind of like know, you know. You have to go right to the spot and do what you're doing. It doesn't ask you questions. It'll slow you down. But, you know, knowing what to do is one of the arts. And when you do it day in and day out, you start learning. You start picking up what happens. You know, I had a teacher today. And you know what? I said, well, you're a teacher, you get a $250 expense for buying supplies. Well, I haven't done that in 5 years. You know, first time since you left $1,000 potential deductions on the table by not deducting it. She's a teacher, and I guess they all talk amongst each other and all. Then I had another teacher for that was $2,500 last week that they could deduct. So it goes both ways. Another one of the big things that people miss, it's not so much critical in Pennsylvania because Pennsylvania has both, you know, an income tax and a sales tax. But some states only have sales tax, they don't have income tax. But in Pennsylvania, the way it works, if you're a senior and you don't pay income tax for Pennsylvania, you could potentially take sales tax if you're itemizing. So there's a little form you can go in, fill it out, put Pennsylvania, and it allocates based upon the income that you have, how much tax you can take. So if your income's maybe $35,000 in retirement, you might be able to take $600, $700 in sales tax because you don't have Pennsylvania income tax. So that's one item that gets missed constantly because, first of all, you have to be itemizing and take advantage of it. And you have to know how to do this. And you have to go, once you find the form, then you have to go dig into the books and find other forms to try to calculate it out. But that's one thing that, you know, helps save potentially lots of money for some people. It adds up year after year, year after year. Another thing, we all have mutual funds. If you reinvest dividends in individual stocks, you know, you have to keep track of the basis when you go to sell it. If you're reinvesting in a mutual fund year after year, and you go to sell, you know, hopefully the fund is supplying you with the information of your reinvestment because that increases your cost. So the reinvestment comes to you like more shares, additional shares, but it also should increase your cost basis. Now, some people that have individual stocks, they can't figure this out. They don't keep the calculations. So they lose these deductions. So they buy 100 shares of, you know, AT&T stock 25 years ago and reinvested it. Now they got 1,000 shares. They go and sell it. They say, you know, bought 1,000 shares at XYZ price, sold it at today's price, but they didn't include that all the reinvesting they put in was money that they already were taxed on when they were paid a dividend. They just put the money and bought additional shares, you know. It's very confusing. So this is another area where a lot of people make a lot of mistakes. If you have mutual funds, it's been a requirement the last couple of years that they calculate this for you and tell you what it is. In prior years, they didn't. So it's getting better. But no one's actually telling you about your individual stocks. If you're holding the certificates at home, and they split and they get it, you know, you have 200 shares, they split, you get another 100 shares, you get another 100 certificate for 100 shares. You know, you have to know that when you sell these shares, what your actual cost is. So it's another step that will save money in the long run. You know, some people are so bad with this that it went on year after year and the parents say are 70, 80, 90 years old now. And they might have worked at AT&T or Bell Atlantic before it became Exelon or whatnot, and they have zillions of shares of AT&T, Bell Atlantic, and it's been reinvesting, accumulating. They're just hoping to die with it. Because what happens, you know, when they die, the price gets stepped up to today's price, the price that the people died at. Say if they had all this AT&T stock, and some of it was bought so many years ago in the 50s or whatever, you know, it's worth 25 cents cost basis. So they can never sell it, it'll be all profit. So what they wind up doing is they die with it in their name, so the kids inherit it at the stepped up today's price. So if the price is $35 today, and that gentleman dies, his kids will inherit it at $35 a share. So you don't have to worry about all the shares are reinvested years and years ago. I had people that worked at Sears from the 30s, you know, from the 40s, had Sears stock all these years, don't know what they paid, because it was always reinvesting, always building up. The next thing you know, they go to sell it, and it's 100% profit. Because the way it's split, you know, it might be $100 a share now, but, you know, when they bought it 80 years ago, the equivalent is 10 cents, 15 cents, 20 cents. So what they wind up doing is, you wait till you die, if you're old enough, and you don't need the money. You know, that's what the Rockefellers do, the Kennedys, you know, the stuff you hear about in the paper and everything else. You die with the stock and let the stepped up basis take care of it. It's one of the things they're trying to eliminate right now because it's such a gift to everybody. You know, it helps, you know, the middle class as much as the upper class.
So the children who inherit then don't pay any kind of tax, like inheritance tax?
No, what happens is they pay inheritance tax. If it's a husband and wife, that's one of the sheets I gave you. If you look at page 2, at the very top it says estate tax. There's federal estate tax on everything over $5.3 million. So it's 40%. So the first $5.3 million is free of estate tax. And the best thing of it is a married couple, it used to be married couples had $600,000 each of basis that they could pass on tax free. And now all of a sudden, it's 5.3 per individual. So you used to have to play a game years ago. You used to have separate trusts, put so many dollars in A trust, a B trust, and then when one person dies, that trust stays and goes to the heirs, and the other, you know, you had to do a lot of end running around. Well, Congress did away with that a couple of years ago, and they said, right now, each individual has $5.3 million that they could pass on tax-free of federal tax. You know, in Pennsylvania, there'll be a Pennsylvania inheritance tax, which is nowhere like 40%. It's 4.5% for children and 15% for just, you know, people that are not relatives. But the way it works is you get 5.3 if you're married, your husband or wife gets 5.3. One person dies, the second person carries over the deceased spouse. So now they have $10.6 million to pass on tax-free. Pennsylvania inheritance tax-free, which is, you know, why not? You know, why should they be taxing that? Because when the person earned it, it was taxed somewhere along the line.
Right.
You know, first of all, a company earned it, paid it as a dividend or paid salary to the people. So they pay tax on it then they had it in stocks or CDs, they pay tax on it as it grew all along, you know, and they've been saving it and not spending it. You know, probably these kind of people are trying to pass it on to their heirs, and all of a sudden they die, and then the government swoops in and takes 80% of it. Is that fair? I don't know. It kind of kills the incentive, you know. First of all, you know, in Chester County, if something like that was around, you know, all these farms and all would be gone because no one could afford to pass them on. No one could buy them. You know, in the Midwest, you wouldn't have any individual farmers. Because a farm is worth, the land is worth, you know, $800,000, $1 million that these people are farming, that they accumulated over 3 or 4 or 5 generations, and all of a sudden, if they had to pay tax on it through an inheritance, they would have to sell it. And only who our farmers would be.
So there's basically no inheritance tax.
Basically no inheritance tax if you have under 10.6 million and they increase it by inflation every year.
Not too many people like that out there.
So.
We don't need to worry.
About 20 years ago, I have a good friend whose father was very successful. He had office buildings, restaurants, all this kind of stuff. And the son was, he just said, my father, you know, he's really good at making money, but I can't even work for him. He's like, he's a driver. You know, he was like 90 years old when he died. And guess what? He died the year they had no inheritance tax, and he left 30-some million.
Whoa.
And he was married three or four times, and there was like 15 stepkids and all this. And they all got together, and they said, the best thing he did was he died this year when they had forgiveness. You know, otherwise, he died like in November of that year. If he would have made it through December, it would have changed everything. Everybody was like, did you put a pillow over him? They were all joking and all. But his father was like pretty mean, I guess, you know, driver. You know, he didn't do what he wanted, you know. Those kind of people. Generally, those kind of people, you know, people that have the money like that and all, you'll never know. You know, the only one you know, the only one that's telling you about all the money he has is Donald Trump. You know, you hear anybody else saying, oh, I'm worth, you know, everybody keeps it quiet, you know. It's all secret, you know. And when we do these taxes, you know, I get people walking in, and then I get some guy walking in, you just never know. And he gives you stuff, and you open it up, you know, $654,000 income. Yeah, you just never know. And it's out there, and it, you know, sometimes it's 1 year stuff. You know, with these pharmaceutical companies, Collegeville being bought, sold, laying people off, buying, getting bought out by Pfizer, you know, stock options coming due. You know, we're seeing people with humongous 1 year shots of gigantic windfalls, and then it's gone. You know, it doesn't duplicate sometimes, you know. So that's another thing with, you know, the money with the inheritance. You know, there's only about, you know, out of the top 1% that they always talk about. You know, you have your Warren Buffetts and all those kind of people. They make it in there year after year. But the rest of the people, there's like a 30% chance that they'll repeat the next year if they're in the top 1%. Then there's like a 2% chance they'll repeat three or four times. You know, it's usually a one-shot thing. They sell a company. You know, this company, Netflix, that you hear about, that, you know, the stock's $400-some dollars. You know, I was actually a Morgan Stanley advisor for 20-some years. And in the 90s, the founder of Netflix used to come around, talk to brokerages because they were selling the stock, and he would come around, talk it up. Because back then, it was like a West Coast video. You know, it was like, who wants, you know, is this thing any good? You know, remember West Coast video, how busy they were? Mm-hmm. And then they're gone.
Yeah.
Blockbuster kind of bought them up, and then they went away, so they popped away. The best thing to have on the West Coast was Blockbuster, because they bought them, at least you got money out of it, and then, you know, but then this Netflix came along, and they were doing the same thing through the mail, you know, and people were saying, well, you know, it's good, but, you know, we don't know how good it is, so the guy, Reed, whatever his last name was, just come around to the offices and tell us, you know, this is like my third business. You know, I started out, did a software company, you know, and I wound up selling it and lost money. I started another software company, you know, I wound up selling it and I made like $100,000. And then, while I was looking to start something else up, you know, I was driving around my car with videos, with DVDs in it, and I went to take them to the place to return them, and I realized they were here for like 3 weeks. And they said I owed $250. You know, I said, this is ridiculous, this is gonna be a better way, you know. And that's how he kind of started that. And when that started up, everybody used to walk around and say, you know, this is, you know, never gonna work. And now this guy, you know, he's a billionaire, just like that. You know, but it was real hard work, and he's been doing it all along. Now he's out there saying that, you know, all the hard work he put in, you know, if he sells his stock, it's all gonna go to taxes. So he's like very, very concerned on how to push this stuff forward, because he wants to have the money go to his kids and charities and stuff, not what the government wants. You know, so, you know, whether or not we believe in this income tax, state taxes or whatnot, you know, you can't really do anything about it because there's a lot of rules and you have to follow the rules. And one of the things, some of the stuff we're gonna do tonight will help you save some money. Let's see what the next one was. Here's another biggie, when we're doing the taxes, the people come in and we're doing Schedule A. Schedule A is where you do the itemized deduction. Schedule A works two ways. You either itemize all your deductions, real estate taxes, mortgage interest, casualty losses, medical bills, stuff along those lines. And if you don't want to itemize, you get what they call a standard deduction. If you're single, it's $6,200. If you're married, it's $11,400 without itemizing. But the people that do itemize, when we get down to taking their mortgage, real estate taxes and whatnot, then we ask them out-of-pocket charity. Some of them have church, and they might have a thing that the church sent them, said we donated $950. But then we say, did you do anything else? I don't think so. Did you ever put anything to Goodwill? Yeah, we get a Goodwill all the time. Well, they give you that little blue card. What do you do with that? No, we throw it out, So you have things like that. So the way Goodwill and Purple Heart and those kind of things work is, if you're donating more than $500, you have to itemize when you donate it. So you go on the Goodwill website, and they tell you what the value of the donated goods are. So if you wind up giving them like 10 pair of pants, people are gonna say, oh, 10 pair of pants and they're $50 each. No, it's not like that. They're gonna say that the value, donated value is $2 each. So 10 pair of pants are gonna be $20 and whatnot. We get people that, husband and wife, husband dies, spouse donates, his 15 suits and 35 pair of pants and shoes and socks and dress shirts and everything else, and it adds up to $1,500 at the Goodwill value. They can take it. Wife dies, all the jackets, shoes, same thing, winds up being $3,000. Sometimes the people do it over 2 or 3 years, but you have to go into the Goodwill site and look at the value of the donated goods. They'll have their dining room tables, wooden four chairs, and you'll say, $250. They'll say $40. You can take the $40 value. Then you won't have any trouble. If the IRS comes after you and says, first of all, something like that, the IRS isn't going to send anybody to your door or anything. They're going to send you a letter saying, we noticed that you took $2,500 in charity costs. Can you please send us the basis, the records from Goodwill or whatever you wrote down there? All you do is photocopy them, send them to the IRS. You'll probably never hear anything else. But if you don't have them and don't send them, then they're going to just turn around, disallow it, and charge you the tax that you would have paid as if you didn't take it, plus interest and penalty along the way. But this is one big thing. I don't know if anybody does that with the Goodwill.
I don't
stuff
put my own. I never go to the Goodwill site. I just put a guesstimate, and I've never got questions.
Yeah, well, theoretically, if they ever did question, they would
question. Good enough.
You have to go to the Goodwill. Goodwill, pretty much everybody uses, no matter where they made it to, because it's the same.
Okay.
They're all similar. Purple Heart. It's, the other thing is with cars, people, and I, on PBS right now, they're running a thing where the guy says, oh, I donated my 30-year-old Jeep kind of thing, and they're real happy about it. They end up getting like $30 for it, stuff like that, because what they do is when you donate something that's real junky, the charities just call up certain junkyards and say, go pick up this car, and then charity gets like $30 from the junkyard because they're going to just scrap it. So if you're going to donate it, your donation value is the $30 that the charity got from the junkyard. Not, like if you look at a book and say, oh, it's worth $500 or $2,000. We get people coming in saying we donated a car and it's worth $13,000 to charity. First of all, the IRS knows not a whole lot of people donate $13,000 cars to charities. Something's got to be wrong. So then they'll ask you for the slip. If you don't have the slip, they'll just recalculate your tax return, so if you didn't give it, add back that deduction, and next thing you know, you owe another, you know, $500 plus interest and penalty. If it doesn't, if they do it 3 years later, the interest and penalty almost doubles, you know, it seems like it doubles the amount, you know, you would owe, so you lost, you didn't make anything. Another thing is student loans. It's all in the rage. That's all you hear about is student loans in the paper now. Terrible, you know. Students, they go and they borrow $100,000, and then next thing you know, they can't get a job. So the way it works is, while the student is the dependent of the parent, if the parent is paying the interest, they can take the deduction for the student interest, for the loan. It's right here on the 1040. If you go down and look towards the bottom, tuition and fees, right above that on line 33, student loan interest. So if you still have children that are in college and you're paying the actual loan and getting the interest statement come in saying it was $890 or whatever, the parents can take it. Now once a student goes out on his own, then what they do is they look, the IRS looks to whoever signed for that, whoever's actually on the hook. Now sometimes the parents are on the hook even though the student, because the parents had to sign or whatever happened. So the parents could be always taking that interest deduction. But most time, it falls on the children. And so then the children can take it, not the parents. Even though the parents might pay it, you know, theoretically, you know, the children still are the only ones that are allowed to deduct it. And sometimes in these situations, you know, when we're doing this, doing the return, when we're doing the parents, we usually catch it, and then next thing you know, the kid gets a job, and they start doing the return itself, and then 2 years later, we wind up doing the return to the children, and all of a sudden we say, well, whatever happened to the interest? So they weren't taking it, because they don't know. They're 23, 45 years old. They're just, hurry up, get the return. If I'm getting a refund, run with the money, you know? So in that case, you know, we can actually refile or amend the return, you know, if there's a big enough difference, get some refund back for people.
But I have a question.
Uh-huh.
Now this is for interest. What about just the tuition, like for college courses?
Right. Well,
is there any kind of deduction for them?
We actually, we're going to jump ahead for that for a second, but it's one here. There's actually a tuition credit.
Tuition credit.
Right. And it used to be called Hope Scholarship along these lines. And right now, if you qualify and spend at least $4,000 on education, higher education, and be at least a full-time student half a year, you can get a $400 tax credit. And tax credits versus tax deductions, does anybody know the difference, sort of, how they work? Well, deductions are what you do when you put on Schedule A, like mortgage interest, real estate taxes, and that comes off your income. If you're making $50,000, you have $5,000 in deductions, then your income's $45,000. You know, tax credits are on the back of the 1040, and the tuition ones are on line 68, American Opportunity Credit, and also up a little higher. Line 50, educational credit. What they do with the $2,500 that you get, they break it into two parts, $2,500. So one line gets $500, one gets $2,000. What these are is actual money coming back to you. So when you have a deduction, you're taking it from your income. When you have a tax credit, it's money coming to you. So if you were gonna get a refund of $2,000 and you get educational credit of $2,500, now you're gonna get $4,500 refund. it's like down money coming right to you. The same thing works the same way with childcare, tax credit. It's money coming right to you. So these are the most valuable. This is the most valuable area of the tax return for deductions. But not really deductions, but the credit's coming back to you. So it also, you know, you can do also and get educational credits even if you're retired and have a vocation doing charity work, and they want you to do a computer programming, you go and take a course, you can get money back on that as a lifetime learning credit. It might be 10 or 20%, it's capped, and it's also phased out based upon your income. If your income's $250,000 a year, you're not going to get any of these credits I'm talking about. But what happens is, you know, we have a lot of people that go back to school in their, you know, 40s and 50s. You know, sometimes, you know, part of it is, you know, funded somehow through an employer, and then they wind up paying $5,000 a year themselves or something like that. They can get part of that back this way through lifelong learning, because they're not full-time. They have to be a full-time student to get these hood credits type things, $2,500.
And so,
you have to be full-time, at least one half a year. And the other thing is you have to, you don't even get it for 4 years. So it's another confusing thing, because, you know, when I went to college, there was a 4-year thing, you know. When the kids go now, it's 4, 5, 6. Mm-hmm. So, when, you know, the parents are getting these credits right now when the students are in college. So if they have 2 kids in college, they get 5,000 in credit coming right to them. So they were real anxious to have them charged each year. But, you know, we lose track. We don't know how many kids, you know, because people come to us 2 years ago. We don't know that the one kid's been getting it for 4 years and the parents can't remember, you know, unless you get the returns, dig it out, try to figure it out. But the IRS knows, you know. So if you send it in wrong, it takes them about a year to figure it out. Then they come back and they rebill you. And then they charge you penalty and interest, so they gave you $2,500, now you gotta pay them back, you know, $3,200 because it was wrong. Job hunting costs, you know, studying, getting out of college and looking for a first job, they can't deduct anything. There's nothing they can do. But once they get their first job, and they hate it, say, or whatever, and they start looking for a second job, then all that's deductible. You know, they can deduct copying resumes, you know, mileage going to interviews, you know, potentially if they had to buy stuff to get a better job, meals, staying overnight, traveling.
Does this have to be a full-time job?
It's a good question, but I don't think not.
College student getting different part-time jobs.
Right.
You know, cab fare to and from interviews.
Right. Well, the first job doesn't count.
Right.
Right. But it, once you had one full-time job, then it would seem to be that anything else. Well, I guess part-time, you know, some part-time jobs are almost full-time, you know. Mm-hmm. I guess 2 part-time would be 1 full-time.
So it depends on the hours of week they work.
Yeah. You know what? I'm sure, and I don't have time, right? But
okay.
If you read the book, I'm sure it's going to qualify.
All right.
You know, but maybe it does work for part time too. I don't know.
Okay.
I don't know. Employment agency fees. And here we get, it's the same thing, moving expenses for your first job. Although job hunting expenses are not deductible, when you finally do get the job and you have to move somewhere, that move, first move, would be deductible. You get to deduct 23.5 cents a mile, plus whatever you pay to parking tolls. There's also military reservists, you know, around here in these areas. There's a lot of reserve places. There's one in Kemerton, but, you know, because the way people move around, sometimes they stay with their unit. So they might be in Jersey and they moved over here, but they're still in the reserves and they want to go back to the Jersey place because that's where all their friends are and whatnot, and they have 2 or 3 or 4 or 5 years to go. They can deduct that because it's, as long as it's 100 miles or more, that start getting deducted also. And there's a lot of people that are reservists. Deduction of Medicare premiums for self-employed. Well, you know, just because you're 66 and you're on Medicare doesn't mean you're not working. You know, some people have their own jobs, consulting jobs, or still working at their regular jobs. What happens is, you know, once you are self-employed and you're on Medicare, you can deduct a lot of this against the business, because it's just like you're getting medical expense, just like you're getting medical insurance somewhere else, because you're paying for it. It's just like getting medical insurance. But if you're on your own, you know, you only can deduct it based upon the exclusions. You know, the way they changed it, what happened was, up until last year, anything over 7.5% of your adjusted gross income and medical expenses was deductible if you're itemizing using Schedule A. So if you made $100,000, anything over $7,500 medically, you can deduct. So the first $7,500 wasn't deductible. Then 2 years ago, they changed it. Now it's 10%. So now anything over 10% or $10,000 in that case is deductible. But people that are seniors at 66 can deduct it still at the 7.5%. So they didn't mess with the seniors when they did this. But everybody else, they kind of nicked them another 2.5%. But if you have your own job, if you're working somehow, there's a way you can deduct the Part B and everything else as an expense. Here's child care credit, which is similar to the educational credit, and you get $1,000. It's subject to income, but you get $1,000 credit. And we see a lot of people with two or three kids, that's $3,000 or $4,000. It is income limited, so if you're making tons of money, it's gonna be limited or you might get nothing. But it's, you know.
And this is children under 18.
Right. Here's an estate tax on income in respect of the decedent. This goes back to, you know, the estate tax and everything else. In the event you inherited money from a wealthy person and they wound up paying estate tax on it, on the money you inherited. Now, in this example, you inherited $100,000 in an IRA, and they were in the 40% estate tax bracket when they died. So $40,000 out of the estate was paid in federal estate taxes. Now when you go to take that money out of the IRA, you can net those taxes that are paid against the amount of money that you're taking out of the IRA, because it will all be 100% taxable. Because it's an IRA, you take it out of an IRA, it's all taxable. So in this example, they take $50,000 out of the IRA. They also get to deduct, because it's 50% of the money, they get to deduct 50% of the tax that was paid, which is $20,000. So they take $50,000 out, they deduct $20,000, they pay tax on $30,000 instead of $50,000. So in the event you inherit money from somebody, long lost aunt that you never heard of, that had millions of dollars, you know, something like this could come into play. He's coming to play a little more because of the lower limits.
And what if you inherit from someone who lives in another country? How does that work?
Well, good luck, because the way it works is, you know, when somebody dies in the United States, they look for the heirs, the U.S. heirs, before they look for the foreign heirs. You know, so unless the foreign heirs know to come claim something, or know they're in a will or something like that, they might be shut out. And it might be the same way.
My mother lives in France.
Yeah.
So I live here.
Right. Well, theoretically, she, you know, depending on her will, you know, you can inherit money, you know.
But would I be taxed over there and taxed over here?
You would be taxed. Well, you would be, it, first of all, you wouldn't be the one being taxed. It's when someone dies here, they're taxing not the people that inherit the money, they're taxing the people the state left before you get the money, the person inherits it. So it's not you paying it, it's the state paying it.
Okay.
And And that's the way I'm assuming it's gonna work over there. And I know that the inheritance rules over there, you know, they take away all the money, you know? That's why no one has money, you know? But they don't have money here.
I heard that, I don't know, at one point, and I think it changes a lot too, but at one point they did away with an inheritance tax in France, but I don't know if it's back or not.
I don't know.
Depends on what part of the EU you live in.
Right.
It's different in Italy, and it's just complicated.
It's all different, you know, Italy and Greece and Spain and Portugal, they all have these problems because, you know, the tax compliance is, you know, Italy and Greece, people try not to, you know, it's cash society. You know, everything's off the books, you know, so, you know, I think there's only like 8 or 9 or 10,000 people in all of Greece that pay over $1,000 income tax. You know, in Greece, you know, but there's, you know, zillions of, you know, that's where they have the problems. This section here, it's hard to read, but what they're saying is if this year, when you do your income taxes, you wind up paying extra to the state of Pennsylvania because they don't take enough out, Pennsylvania will take out, you know, pretty much 3.067 of what you owe on wages, but, you know, dividends, unless you file an estimated form, you know, nothing's taken out, so you usually wind up paying to the state. You may wind up paying something locally because they took out wrong. And so what happens is, say you end up paying an extra $500 to the state of Pennsylvania and $100 to Berkheimer or wherever, depending on where you live. Well, that amount that you're paying could be deducted next year. The amount you paid last year could be deducted this year.
To the state?
To the state, right?
Oh yeah, because that exactly happened to me.
Right.
I had to pay $500.
Right. Right. So if you paid $500 last year, last April to the state,
right,
when you're doing your income tax this year, you add $500 more that you paid into the state as a deduction.
Where is that on this form?
Well, it's Schedule A.
Okay.
It's on Schedule A, and if you're doing it on a software, generally the software will ask you prior year tax payments, do add filing, and then you put in like $200 or $500. You know, if it doesn't ask you, then you just have to know to add it in or put it in as a separate line item.
And that's a deduction.
Right. Now, the flip side of that is if you get a state refund and you deduct your taxes, if you do the Schedule A, deduct taxes, if you got money back from 2013, now you gotta add that back as income. That's right here.
$8 or something.
Oh, never mind.
That's gonna be right here on line, on the 1040, it's line 10, taxable refunds, credits, offset state and local income taxes. So if you get money back, you gotta add it back. If you wind up paying, you know, they ask you, they make sure you see that if you get money back. But if you wind up paying money, they don't tell you how to do it. You know, it's hidden somewhere in this pile of paper. But you have to know how to do it on your own.
Now, right? This is just the state, right?
And the local.
And the local?
Right.
Okay.
Refinancing points. When you first buy a house, the first time you get it, buy a house and you get a mortgage, you pay points, you can deduct them all that year. But you turn around 2 years later and refinance it, then you have to amortize the points over the 30 years or 15 years, whatever you did. In this example here, the points are $33 a year for each 1,000 of points you paid. If you pay 5,000 in points, which probably be huge, you know, you get to deduct, you know, $140 a year. If you don't do it in 10 years, that's $1,400 of deductions you passed up. You know, and then if you go and refinance again or sell the house, you can write off the balance right away.
I tried to do that, but my accountant said that I couldn't because I refinanced last year.
Then you should. then you have to take something like this and shell.
In 2013, yeah.
Right. Because it's, you know, you can't. It happens all the time. People refinance 3 or 4 or 5 times. The way the rates were falling the last couple of years.
Yeah. Is it worth it to do an amendment or like what do they call it when you just like
amend the return?
Is it worth
right.
it? Sometimes?
Well, if you left $1,000 on the table that you could have deducted off and you were in the 20% tax bracket, you just threw away $200. So if you amend the return, you get $200 more back.
I had a situation with this accountant. I had a business before, and she found something that she thought that I could get back, and she amended 3 years worth.
Yeah,
and
right.
charged me $750 to do the
right.
amendments.
Right.
And the refund that she thought that I was going to get was denied, and I ended up paying her that money.
Right.
So I'm really leery to do any kind of amendments,
right.
even if it's for a couple hundred. Because
right.
that's exactly what she said to me. She said, well, if you sold $400 on the floor, would you pick it up? And that was her incentive for
right.
me amending 3 years' worth of taxes.
Yeah, well, in that case, they probably should have, you know, if they talked you into it based upon that, they probably should have waived the fees, you know.
Oh, they didn't.
But then you go to someone else. That's H&R Block.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
Right. But you know, that's what.
Oh, well, that's another question. Can you deduct the fees that you pay for
right.
an accountant?
Yeah, you can deduct it. It's on Schedule A.
Okay.
But your adjusted gross income, which is this number here, the last number on the 1040, you take 2% of that. So if it's $50,000, 2% of that is $1,000. So anything over $1,000, you can deduct. So on the Schedule A, there's a little box down here full of all the miscellaneous deductions that you can take.
2%.
But they're subject to 2% of your adjusted gross income. So you have to be over $1,000 worth of taxes and items that you pay for in order to make it worthwhile. Jewelry pay, you know, what happens is same thing here. If you get jewelry pay, which is minimal, you know, maybe $50 a day or whatever it is, IRS, they have it right here. If you get it, they want you to declare it and pay tax on it. But, you know, a lot of times, a lot of companies will pay you, and then you can turn it over to them. A lot of companies want you to turn it over, they won't pay you. You know, if you wind up paying it, there's no easy spot. Where did I turn it over? You know, it's another one of these hidden deductions. You know, so you can actually add your fees to a write-off on the profit line on the Schedule A. So, you know, you don't want to pay twice if you don't have to. Yeah. American Opportunity Credit, that's the 2,500 educational credits that we already spoke about. This college credit for those long out of college. This is the another, you know, not necessarily college students, you know, older people taking extra courses to improve their career.
If your employer pays for part of your college, but not all,
right.
can you deduct what they don't pay?
Right, the part they don't pay. Plus, you probably can deduct, you know, maybe mileage if it's a faraway college. It might be worthwhile.
Okay.
Here's a, when you, you know, the airports, the airlines are killing you.
Yeah.
You know, baggage claim, just ridiculous. Well, you know, as a company, employer paid person, there's nothing you can do about it. But if you own your own company, all those fees for traveling, all the baggage stuff, you can deduct all that stuff. That's at least one way of getting something back. Credit for energy saving home improvements. They used to have, up until recently, you know, you could upgrade your refrigerators and air conditioners and heaters and all and get credits. It's pretty much done. All that's been phased out, and there is only solar energy credits available now for solar water heaters, the you know, the things they put on the roofs, the black paints,
solar panels,
you know,
yeah.
stuff like that.
So new windows and all that.
No, that's gone.
Gone?
Yeah, it's gone. You would have had to take advantage of it a couple of years ago when it was all out there. But there is still solar ones, and there's actually a company in California called Solar City. It's owned by the same guy who does the Tesla automobile, and they'll actually like install a solar system on your home and charge you pretty much what the old utility was charging you, and then you'll get a payback. You might even make money out of it because they're amortizing over 20 years and they're getting like a 30% tax credit themselves because you're passing it on through them. So it's pretty neat. You know, it's not as big around here because weather, you know, California where it's more sunny, it's bigger. You know, they can actually, if you call this Solar City place up, call them up and say, you know, I'm interested in getting my home surveyed. While you're on the phone, they have the ability to look at that Google Earth thing and look at the top of your house, and they have some kind of enhanced version that before a couple seconds go by, they know how many square feet your roof is and where the sun is and what to do. It's pretty neat.
They're California-based, though?
Yeah, Solar City.
Okay.
But they do it out here. They do it everywhere, actually. Okay. But it might not be as worthwhile. Actually.
Right.
This is the bonus depreciation that we talked about in the beginning, where if you are in business owners who include running businesses out of their home, mm-hmm. you know, they have the ability to deduct up to $500,000 instead of depreciating items. It's called 179 deduction, where you can take the cost right away. Whereas the company I was talking about earlier, the company itself is a subchapter S corporation, which means all the profits flow right to the owners, 1040, their income statement. And so what they like to do is, you know, if they look like they have, you know, a $300,000 or $400,000 a year, they would buy $200,000 in equipment and write that off. So now they're going to have to pay tax on $100,000 instead of $300,000. So that way the tax kind of subsidizes them buying the machinery, stuff like that. So you can do that on your own. You know, I think two of you have part-time businesses here. This stock thing, and I don't, did anybody here have the, you know, over like the last 10 years, if you had shares, if you had life insurance for like Manulife, Sun Life, Prudential, you got shares. They used to be mutually owned companies. I mean, they were like owned by the stockholders, then they became public companies, and they wound up giving everybody shares. I don't know if anybody got any of that here and there. But what happened is they gave, when they became a stockholding company, they gave everybody shares, and the federal government said that the shares had no cost basis, so that if you sold it, Prudential ones were like $40 a share as soon as they gave them out. So if you sold them at $40, you got 100 shares for $4,000. They're saying all $4,000 is profit. But if you read this little article here, you can actually claim that there's a basis of like 30, 40, 50%. So you don't pay tax on 100% of the money. It's not all found money. People that had large life insurance policies, like you were saying, you go back to 3 years. You know, we went back three years on some of these people that sold. You know, they got 10,000 shares of Prudential and sold it for $80 a share when it was high and paid 100% tax on everything. We went back and refiled it, you know, saved them a lot of money. Waiver of penalty for newly retired. This is the year you retire, you're actually retiring. And if you're doing your taxes and you're getting the money, you know, while you're working, right before you're getting ready to retire, you finally got it right that, you know, when you go to do your income tax, you owe very little or you get very little back. You know, you got it real close. Then you retire and you quit in June. And next thing you know, when you go to do your tax, you owe a whole lot of money because now you're out of sync. You didn't have enough money taken out of your pay. You know, they gave you extra money because you're leaving. They gave you, you know, 90 days of vacation pay. They didn't take out the taxes correctly. You know, you got stock options, all of a sudden you owe a lot of money. Well, in that year you retire, it's very easy to go back to the government and say, hey, I retired, I didn't know, you know, my income was just shooken like crazy, and I'm retiring, and everything's out of whack. you go back to the government and get them to waive a lot of these penalties. It's almost pretty much automatic. So that's something to keep in mind. Amortization of bond premiums. If you have bonds, you know, everybody's talking about how interest rates were falling and bond prices went up, if you know what I'm talking about. Well, you used to be able to buy bonds for $1,000, which is par value, now you're going to pay $1,040 for the same bond because the price went up because the yields went down. Well, if you read this little discussion, it may be very, very profitable for you to amortize, take the bond increase year over year and deduct it instead of waiting to the end when you're selling it, because it might keep you, it might take your tax bracket a little lower to benefit from, we'll skip the alimony one, I guess. One of the biggest tax breaks around for people, it's this. If you look at the page one of this handout, and you look at the corner where it says capital gains and qualified dividend taxes for 2015, and it has the brackets. If you're in the 15% tax bracket or below, your capital gains tax for 2015 is zero. Does anybody know what this means, how this works? This is like, you know how you heard that when Romney was running for president, he was paying 15% in taxes, mm-hmm. and everybody else is paying whatever, yeah. you know?
30, 40.
Right, because he has no salary income. All his income came from capital gains. Yeah, he has salary income. He probably had like, $20 million in capital gains, dividend kind of income. He probably had, you know, $100,000 in salary. When you blend it together, it comes out at, you know, 15.2% or something like that. But the way it actually works is especially retired people, they try to do this. They try to keep their income, husband and wife, under this limit to get the zero capital gains. You take the 15% tax bracket that they're talking about here, you go up to the married section, and you find out where the 15 tax bracket is. It's right here. Second one down.
Okay. If you single, it's down.
Yeah. Second one's there. Okay. Now, what's this mean? If you look at the second column over, you see 74,900. What this means is you can be married and have $30,000 of income, say earned income, right? And take the difference of 30,000 from the 74, which is 44. You can have $40,000 in dividends and income and pay zero tax on that.
Oh.
So your effective tax rate would be like 2% or 3%. You'd have Romney and all those guys beat.
Wow.
They're actually doing the same thing. They're just doing it so that they can make 15. Well, back then when the election was on, it was 15. It's since been raised to like 20. It's also been raised again for higher income people.
Wow. And the same marks, second line for the single people?
Yeah, the second line for single people, the exclusion is everything over
37,450.
So basically what happens is a lot of retired people, they get Social Security, which is basically not taxable, depending on how much money you have in other areas, right? But if you wind up having the money in dividends, basically you wind up paying up to 74,000. You can wind up almost paying zero income. You know, I have retired people that have earned income of 80,000, so none of this is applicable. because their earned income pushed them already over to 74,000. But there's a lot of people that could manage their money in such a way that they can keep their earned income, the rest of the stuff, off the 1040. They could wind up having dividends, you know, 20,000, interest, 10,000, you know, capital gains down here, 10,000, you know, Social Security over here, 45,000, and pay no tax. As long as it's under the 74. Once it goes over to 74, then the capital gain starts getting taxed at 15%. So this is like people trying to manage their income, you know, and every year that goes up. When Romney, the thing was in the news about Romney and all that, it was 69,000, so it's already up to 74 because it goes up by inflation. But this is one of the, you know, things that, you know, the people that come in, the older people that come in, that really know how this works, they're always like pushing it to make sure this happens somehow. Doing this, doing that. But that's one of the biggest gifts around. And nobody knows. Did anybody know any of that? That's probably the best thing around. You know, I know and I try it, but unfortunately with that one income and all that, it doesn't work, you know. But, you know, now that I'm getting to the age, once my wife retires, you know, maybe we can do something like that and make that kind of work for us.
So you wouldn't pay any taxes on dividends, on any kind of financial investment gains?
Right, capital gains. Right.
Okay.
So, you know, that's what these are. If you look at the second page I gave out, it's also a lot of goodies on stuff that works. A lot of it's going to be not applicable. You know, if you go over, you know, I did somebody's tax return this morning and they wound up owing, I guess it was like $450 in taxes, and what they wanted to do is pay nothing. So they had a brokerage account at Merrill Lynch that had, you know, a couple thousand in the money market, and have an IRA at Merrill Lynch. So what we did was we went into the computer as, you know, I said, well, let me see if we put $1,000 in your IRA, how much, you know, eventually putting in about $2,000 made her tax income zero. So she's calling up Merrill Lynch tomorrow to transfer $2,000, so she pays no tax. Mm-hmm. Due, you know, she paid tax, but she didn't want to have to pay anything at the end of the year. So she's deducting the IRA contribution, you know, to not pay anything at the last minute. You know, that, you know, shows you on here all the different phase outs, you know, Roth IRAs. You know, if you go down the over here, a Roth IRA, you put money in, you can't deduct it, you can't take it off your income tax. You put the money in a Roth and it grows tax free when you take it out, and you can die. I can have a Roth and die, and my kids can inherit it, and it'll grow tax-free on their name. Mm-hmm. And then guess what? They can die, and their kids can have it too. So, you know, this could be like a big transfer, transferring money into the future, you know, if it's large enough, you know, versus if you wind up in a regular IRA, you know, I have a regular IRA, and I die after my wife, you know, the last one dies, my kids will inherit it, but my kids are going to have to start taking money out of that IRA, you know, based upon their life expectancy, you know, and then their kids can inherit it, but they're being forced to draw it out. Or these Roths, you're not. You know, that's why the government's already trying to shut down these Roths a little bit. That's one of these proposals they have out there, limited. They actually have it phased out, that depending on your income, you can't even have put money into them. But it's sort of a higher limit, but they know that, you know, people want to put money in it, in them. So they did have, a couple years ago, they had an amnesty where you could actually convert your IRA, taxable IRA, into a Roth and pay tax on it and roll it over. You know, and that was actually with Morgan Stanley at that time, and then every day people were doing it, and then it stopped. But I, you know, at first I didn't think it was a good idea until I started seeing all the people doing it, and then really started thinking about it. There's nothing better than tax-free money down the road. I guess pretty much towards the end, I have a few more items here.
Maximum earnings before Social Security benefits are reduced.
Right.
If you are under full retirement. I have a friend who's 64.
Right.
He took retirement at 62 because he was ill with cancer.
Right.
And now he's 64, bought a new house, and so he's going back full time.
Right.
How is that going to affect his income?
Well, what he's going to have to do is, it's on here, once he earns over 18, what is it? It's on here, I just can't pick
it
up.
It says under full retirement, but he's not under full retirement age, he's only at 64.
Yeah, he's under full retirement age. Full retirement age for him might be 66.
He was born in 50.
Yeah, it's 66,
yes,
for sure.
So this year he'll be 65.
Right, so he's going to he's going to have a penalty once he reaches, what's the limit on here? I can't pick it out.
Well, it says here, though, maximum earning before.
Yes, 15. Once he makes $15,000,
mm-hmm.
he's going to lose $1 for every $2 of earning.
Oh, boy. I don't think he realizes that.
Well, they're going to take it away. They're not going to know. So, well, unless he tells Social Security to stop paying him, which would probably be a smart idea.
Okay.
If he doesn't, Social Security's going to wind up knowing this time next year, the employers fire all the information,
okay.
and they're going to stop paying him his Social Security for like a number of months till they get the money back that he should have paid in or over, you know, was overpaid, and then they'll restart it up again. The good thing is,
yeah.
is because he made more money, it might increase the amount he's going to earn from Social Security down the road when everything straightens itself out.
He won't make as much money as he did the last year that he worked.
Yeah, well, they base it upon 40 years, so, you know, if he made a little bit of money, you know, he might have had years over those 40 years where he made zero and had to fill in a year or something. Who knows?
But this is so, like, such a gray area to me. I'd like to understand the concept.
Yeah.
He's been drawing for the past 2 years.
Right.
Social Security.
Right.
He's ill. Now he's fine.
Right.
He's going back to work.
Right.
So do you think he should be stopping Social Security?
Probably. He's going to earn over the 18, over the...
He's going to have a base salary of $50,000.
Yeah, well, he's going to go over it, right?
Right.
He's got to stop.
So he has to stop it.
Right. They're going to stop it for him.
But
they're
also, going to take away they're only going to take 50% of what he makes if he keeps pulling Social Security, but if he stops Social Security,
say he's getting $1,000 a month, right?
Mm-hmm.
So they're going to, for everything over $15,700, they're going to take away $1 for every $2 he earns. So they're only going to take away the amount to the equal to $1,000.
Oh, you mean they're just going to take it? Oh, I thought
they're
meant
his
income.
No, they're going to take away his Social Security.
Oh, they're going to take
right.
50% of his Social Security.
Right.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Right.
Well, okay,
right.
Gotcha.
Right.
Not forever, just
while you work.
Okay.
Sorry,
yeah.
about you.
Yes.
That's right.
Thank you.
Do you have any questions?
Very informative.
You know, you get that.
Yes.
My card.
Yes.
Yes.
If you want
Thank
to learn
you.
It, you know, about how that capital gains works.
Yeah.
You know, keep an eye on that.
Yes. Well, thank you.
See you.